Hello everyone and welcome to today's session. I, Sakshi Taresh Khanna, on behalf of Department of Computer Science, Ramlal Anand College, would like to thank all of you for joining us for today's webinar. Today we are presenting Quantum Computing, the next step in computing, which will be presented by Mr. Abhigyan Mishra and Mr. Ritik Joshi. Before we actually start, just a little housekeeping before we get started. All of you are requested to be on mute. If you have any questions during the presentation, please type them into the chat window. We will bring them up during the presentation and we will also have time for questions at the end. Now, without further ado, we will turn the time over to Mr. Abhigyan Mishra, who is our first presenter for today's event. He is a brilliant scholar from our student community and having his own blog on quantum computing, which is very well received. Over to you, Mr. Abhigyan Mishra.
Good morning, everyone. First of all, I'd like to thank the department and the college for giving me this opportunity to present my views on quantum computing as the future of computing. So let's just get started. So the things I'll be covering, or me and Ritik will be covering in this session. First of all, I'll try to give you an overview of what quantum computing is, what led to the rise of quantum computing, why do we need to go quantum, and then I'll talk about some quantum computing concepts, or you can say them, some physics concepts which work in quantum computing to a benefit. And then I'll talk about the algorithm. You'll know about the algorithm when we talk about it. It's, you can say, a sort of surprise. And then I'll briefly describe about the use cases of quantum computing, from where Ritik Joshi will take on and give you a more elaborate and you can say elaborate explanation on exact you can say use cases of quantum computing. Yeah. So let's start. The very first section is the overview. So the first question which comes into our mind is, why do we need to go quantum? Because we already have classical computers and they work just fine. So what is the basic deal of a quantum computer? So if you are from a computer science background, you already know about Moore's law, which basically says that the number of transistors on an integrated circuit doubles after every 2 years. So we already know that the transistor is the, you can say, smallest processing unit of a classical computer. So doubling the number of transistors on an IC means doubling the capacity of a classical computer to compute problems. So, but the problem here is that when we talk about putting more transistors on an integrated circuit, what we are saying is we are making the transistor smaller and smaller. But as you see in the graph, this which shows a trend of, you can say, the size of the transistors as we go forward. So the graph has flattened as we reached 2020. And the reason behind this being that there's a limit to which we can decrease the size of a transistor. After a certain point, it just reaches subatomic level where you can say the principles of quantum mechanics comes into play, and they do not work in our benefit. They actually lead to, you can say, disadvantages and not ideal, you can say, consequences. So you can describe the period after 2021 to be post-silicon era, because we can't no longer, you can depend on silicon and transistors to be the only possible solution to computing. So we need some you can say some or some option. So that's where quantum comes in. So what exactly is a quantum computer? Well, the term quantum computer is made of two words, quantum and computer. You can say a quantum computer uses the quantum mechanical principles to its advantage and is used in information theory. So why do we want a quantum computer? So the first thing we'll as we go forward with the webinar, you'll notice it that you get a significant boost in the performance when solving certain problems. And certain problems, like you can say NP-hard problems, like traveling salesman problem, vehicle routing problem, optimization problems. These problems are well handled on a quantum computer, and you can say they have a very high efficiencies compared to that its classical counterpart. So let me give you a brief idea about the history of quantum computing. The foundation of quantum computing was laid down by Richard Feynman. What he was able to prove that he was able to prove that you can use certain quantum mechanical principles in information theory and in you can say computer theory to its advantage. So, but however, it was not before 1994 that the very first, you can say, commercially viable or you can say a significant algorithm which has any practical rules you use was developed by Peter Shor, known as Shor's algorithm. If you know about cryptography or if you have been in that field, you already know that the Shor's algorithm is a big name. What it says is that what it does, it just, you can say, finds the prime factor of a given number. So the person with the background in cryptography already know that these prime numbers are, you can say, the basic aspect of the whole RSA algorithm. So the Shor's algorithm basically says that you can easily break RSA encryption. And the algorithm was followed by Grover's algorithm in 1996. However, it took more than 20 years before IBM actually made the first commercially available quantum computer. I will recommend you, if you are interested in this field, you should go and check out IBM Q website. They are, you can say, leading in this quantum supremacy race right now. So what exactly is what exactly makes a quantum computer special? We already know about bits. We work them zeros and ones, classical bits. So, but its classical, you can say, its quantum counterpart is a quantum bit, or you can say a qubit. So the thing I want you to pay attention when I see these things, a qubit also has two possible endpoints, or you can say two possible end values, being zero and one. But the thing which actually separates a qubit from a bit is that a qubit can be in a state which is a which is a combination of this zero and one. So for example, you can see right here that this omega is a qubit, and this is a combination of zero and one with a coefficient alpha and beta. This alpha and beta is nothing but, you can say, the probability that this given qubit will, on measurement, we'll talk about measurement, so don't worry if you don't understand some things. If you measure this qubit, the probability of finding zero is alpha square, the probability of finding one is beta square. So how this, or what this whole phenomenon is known as, this is, it is known as superposition. We'll talk about superposition in the later part, and let's move forward. So, okay, we talked about, already explained that a given qubit can be in a state which is a combination of both zero and one, denoted by alpha and beta. So how does it improve the power, or what makes a quantum computer more powerful? So when we talk about a classical computer, what we are saying is that if you double the number of transistors, then you are basically doubling the computing power of a given classical computer. But the things in quantum case is that if you add a single qubit, double the capacity of a quantum computer to compute problems. So we are already looking at, you can say, what makes a quantum computer more special, or what makes it more powerful. Then let me give you, a brief distinction between a classical and a quantum computer. In case of a classical computer, the basic unit is a binary bit, which is either 0 or 1. In case of a quantum computer, it is a qubit, which you can say is a vector notation, or a vector combination of both 0 and 1. When talking about computing, a classical computer works on logical operations, whereas a unitary, or you can say a quantum computer, works on a unitary operation. We'll talk about all these topics, so don't feel lost in anything. So when we talk about classical computer, we use a truth table in order to describe how the state of a given classical bit is changing. Its quantum counterpart is a unitary matrix. The classical computer are irreversible in nature, so most of the gates only run forward. However, the gates in case of a quantum computer are reversible. And this is important. I want you to pay attention when I say this. In classical computers, you can easily copy, the bits from one location to another. However, it is not possible to copy the state of a given qubit in quantum realm. This is known as no cloning theorem. And I've written an article on it. And it's quite interesting because it basically tells you that although you can recreate a given qubit, but however, it is not possible for me to be like that. Yes, I have this qubit. I also want you to have this qubit. So I'll just give you a copy of this qubit. It is not possible in quantum realm. Then I talk about noise. This is where you can say that a classical computer can beat a quantum computer presently. So in present scenario, what your computer you are using, they do not have any error or are not prone to noise. You can expect a classical computer to have an error one time in a whole year. However, in case of quantum computer, where we are right now, the error percentages are very high. So where we stand today, so John Preskill, who is a well-known, renowned personality in the field of theoretical physics and quantum computing, he described this error to be NISQ error. What is NISQ? Well, NISQ is a short form for, noisy intermediate scale quantum, which means that the qubit which we are preparing right now are very noisy, and they are full of deviation and error, and they do not have a very good high life. So some models and it's important to say that various big names, big companies are already in this quantum computing realm. companies like IBM, Google, Alibaba, Rigetti, D-Wave. All of them are continuously, you can say, working on researching and improving the quality of qubits and moving forward with this quantum computing era. So there are three basic models: gate model, which you can say is somewhat similar to a classical model, however, it is very prone to error. A topological model is, just, you can say, is a more theoretical model. It is less prone to error, but is still in theory. An annealing model is, you can say, the oldest model of quantum computing. It works on the nature, you can say, it works on the nature's rule of being in a minimum state of energy. They work there for optimization problems. However, they are not significantly useful for solving certain classical problems. So that that's the end of the, you can say, the overview describing what is a quantum computer and why do we need a quantum computer. Now I'll talk about some concepts, the quantum computing concepts that will be used in the later part of the webinar. So I'll raise a question here. I have talked to various people from physics backgrounds, and all of them describe quantum physics to be hard. Well, it's because they already know, but to give a description to others who are not so familiar with quantum physics. Quantum physics is not hard because of, you can say, big formulas or mathematics. Quantum physics is actually hard because there are some ideas which we come forward in quantum physics are counterintuitive. We are not used to accepting those ideas because as we look around our surroundings and environment, all of these things work on classical principles. So we are not used to accepting these quantum principles as a mean of, you can say, how things work out in a subatomic realm. So some counterintuitive ideas which you must accept while, you can say, while we are dealing with quantum computing are, you can say, a physical system which has been completely isolated from the environment can still behave randomly. And you can say this is implication of your, or this its implication is superposition, which we'll talk about in the later part. And the second idea is that two systems which are completely isolated from each other and you can say separated by huge distances can still be correlated with each other. You can say this is the basic idea of quantum entanglement, which we'll also you can say discuss in the later part. So now some basic concepts in quantum mechanics. So the uncertainty principle, I guess all of you are already familiar with uncertainty principle. We study them in, you can say, class 12th, 11th in chemistry and physics. So what the uncertainty principle says is that when you apply a measurement or when you try to measure a given physical property of a given system, you are basically destroying the state of the given system. We are familiar with a more classical definition that if you were to try to measure the position and the, you know, momentum of a given it is not possible to measure both of these values simultaneously. So that we already familiar with that. Then it says superposition. I've already told you that a qubit can exist as a superposition of both 0 and 1, or you can say a conjugate or a combination of these states. Entanglement, I've already talked a brief about quantum entanglement, that two systems can interact with each other even though they are separated by huge distances. Now we'll know decoherence is another important topic. You can say decoherence is a disadvantage while we work with quantum computers. So what we already if you know the literal meaning of the word term coherence, what it says is that the coherence can be defined as a capacity of various particles in a given system to behave as one system. So if I, you can say, if I have a system which has multiple particles, then if the system is coherent, then all these particles in you can say exist as a single entity or a single system. Whereas decoherence means that these particles will have individual identity and will not behave as a system. So that works in, against the, you can say, a quantum computer. So now then, what are the some main features of a quantum computer? Well, the very first being it uses a qubit. The second being it uses quantum parallelism. What is a quantum parallelism? You can say quantum parallelism is an implication or is an application of quantum superposition to our advantage. So because I already, if you can understand that I already said that a superposition means that a given qubit is in a state which is a combination of both 0 and 1. So if we have a state which is a combination of 0 and 1, we can apply this given qubit through a function and work with values which are both 0 and 1. So you're actually looking at multiple values simultaneously. So that is what is the basic principle of parallelism, classical parallelism also. So that's what quantum parallelism is. Then we have entanglement. And the fourth being we try to maintain coherence. Okay, so what makes a qubit special? We have already talked that what qubit is. A qubit follows quantum mechanical principles, so it allows us to have a you can say, the given qubit to be in a superposition of both 0 and 1. So we are already familiar with this notation of a given qubit, or this is known as vector notation. There's another notation. If you're from a physics background, you must have heard the term ket notation. But to keep things simple, I'll just say that this is nothing but a 2x1 matrix, and where this alpha and beta are the coefficient, the square of these coefficient, you can say describe the probability that on measuring the value, you can say on measuring this qubit, I'll get a one, I'll get a zero, or I'll get a one. So until now, we have been talking about, you can say, numerical representation of a qubit. So how do we actually represent them pictorially, or you can say in three dimensions? So this is known as a Bloch sphere. And as if you're from a physics background, you also have must have heard the term about, you can say, Hermitian space. So this is what you can say, that this Bloch sphere is a Hermitian space, and the qubit is denoted as a vector, which makes a particular angle with, you can say, z-axis, and particular angle with x-axis or y-axis. And by these angles, we can describe the state of a given qubit. And if you're curious, let me tell you the formula. The formula goes like this: omega is equal to, you can say, cos theta by 2 plus e to the power I phi sine theta by 2. I think it's also the polar notation of a vector. You already sort of have an idea that where this comes from. So yeah, another thing I want to point out here is that because we have three axes, the measurement is also possible on three axes. So what I'm trying to say here is that when the qubit is pointing upward, like this, like when the skim qubit is pointing just, you can say, parallel to the z-axis, it is in the state 0. When it is pointing downward, it is in the state 1. The same goes for all axes if it is if you're measuring along the y-axis. Okay, let me tell you, you can say measurement is a physical process. So measurement destroys the state of a given qubit. We'll talk about it when I talk about superposition, but for now, this idea should be sufficient. And when we measure about y-axis, then this represents zero, while the opposite direction represents one. And the same for the x-axis. So now we'll try to describe quantum computing in a nutshell. Well, quantum computing makes use of a superposition and interference to its advantage to prepare, you can say, to change the state of the qubit to a required state. So what are the steps of a, you can say, a quantum computer? First of all, another important thing to note here is that quantum computer works on circuit. So we start with a qubit and we put it on an initial state, say it's in zero state, and then we pass the given, I'm talking about gate model here, there are different models as well. So when I pass this given qubit, which is in its initial state, through a quantum gate, the quantum gate, you can say, is a quantum counterpart of classical gate, which changes the state of the given qubit. So it changes the state of a given qubit. So you can also say that it provides interference, or you can say constructive interference to the given qubit, because there are two types of interference, constructive and destructive. So constructive, you can say, describe the interference which makes us reach to the close to the state we want to achieve, and destructive will be against that. So we try to improve the constructive interference and reach as close as possible to the required state. And if, when we feel like we are close to the state which we want, we measure it. And I already told you the previous slide that measurement is a physical process. And whenever we apply measurement, we actually destroy the state of a given qubit. So it has to either point upward, or you can say zero, or point downward, or you can say one. So now further discussing quantum gates. A quantum gate works on one or more qubits, just like classical gates. But what are some important properties of a quantum gate? Well, quantum gates are reversible. So you can display, this is an important point, because this is the quantum computing is a reversible computing. And this is another important aspect of research and all. And the second being that, because we I have already described that we can represent the given qubit in ket notation, or as a matrix, 2x1 matrix. So it makes sense that if you want to describe that how the given gate changes the state of the given qubit, we also represent each gate as a unitary matrix, and we just multiply the matrix with the matrix associated with the state of the given qubit to obtain a new state which describes the new state of a given qubit. So that's mathematically they are represented as unitary matrices. And the last being that I talked about coherence. So we know that even if we pass the given qubit through a gate, then the qubit must maintain its identity, because the gates being reversible, if I were to apply the gate again, I should get the same qubit which I input, which I did input in the first gate. So the qubit must maintain the identity. So here are some single qubit gates. First of all, they are X, Y, and Z gate. We already know on a Bloch sphere, we saw that there are three axes, or three axes of rotation, and three axes on which we can represent a given qubit. So the X gate can literally mean that, you rotate the given qubit along the X axis by an angle of 180 degree, because we are talking about the Bloch sphere here. We are talking about, you can say, states and vectors. So everything here is related to rotations. And already said that we need to have an angle theta and phi to represent a qubit. So it makes sense that every quantum gate actually applies a certain rotation to the given state of a given qubit. So X, Y, and Z gate does exactly that. The X gate rotates at about X axis by an angle of 180 degree, Y rotates along Y axis, and Z rotates along Z axis. And the T gate is nothing but you can say the fourth root of Z gate, or you can say that it just rotates by an angle of 45 degree. R phi gate is also in, R phi gate is nothing but you can say it rotates the given qubit along the Z axis by an arbitrary angle phi. Now, I'd like to point out another important gate being the Hadamard gate. So what Hadamard gate is, what it does is you pass a given qubit through Hadamard gate, and the qubit, the output you obtain is, it is in superposition. So what exactly superposition means here is that the given qubit is in a state that if you were to measure that given qubit, it will have a 50% probability of being zero and 50% probability of being state one. So if you try to imagine the Bloch sphere, so you'll, it makes sense that if this was, if Z axis was our axis of rotation, then Hadamard gate will, you can say, put the given qubit, you can say perpendicular to the Z axis, because then it would make sense, because then the angle which it makes along Z from upward Z or on the downward Z will be equal. So the probability will also be equal. So you can also say, to put it in layman's term, that Hadamard gate changes the basis of, you can say, measurement, because we went from Z axis, putting with a qubit where you can say initially it was zero, we putting from starting it with zero, pointing upward, we went on to put it on the x-axis, parallel to the x-axis. So we are basically changing the, you can say, the base of measurement. This comes handy when we talk we'll talk about, you can say, the quantum algorithm in the later part. So I want you to keep that in mind. So let me describe a simple circuit to you to make you familiar with how you can say the quantum gate works and how quantum computing works. So we have a simple circuit here. We start with a state zero, and we apply some gates. I don't want you to be worried about this. You just need to, you just pay attention to this Bloch sphere. So we already know what a Bloch sphere is. So we start with a zero. We apply Hadamard gate. So as I already said, that Hadamard gate will put it in a superposition. Therefore, it means says that it was, if this was Z axis, then, and this was X axis, so the qubit now becomes parallel to the X axis, so that it has a 50% probability of being in state both zero and one. Then we apply Z gate, and we already know that the Z gate is a 180 degree rotation along the Z axis. So it gets rotated then pointing in the, you can say, the opposite direction, because this is the Z axis. And then we apply Hadamard gate again. So as I said, that all the gates are reversible in quantum computing. So this Hadamard will, you can say, cancel this Hadamard, and will, but because we changed the phase, don't get worried about the term phase. It's just, you can say, I switched the position of the given qubit and made it point in the backward direction. So now the Hadamard gate will uncompute the previous Hadamard and point downward. So we effectively change the state zero to state one. Now, this was, you can say, an intuitive way of describing how the quantum, you can say, the circuit works. More mathematical way would be that there are two methods of, you can say, mathematically solving it. The first would be, we know that the zero can be represented as 1, 0. So I can start, I can just start multiplying 1, 0 with the matrix associated with Hadamard, which we know is 1 by under root 2, 1, 1, 1, minus 1. And then with the answer we obtain, we multiply again with the matrix associated with Z gate and then with Hadamard. But it's quite lengthy, and I like the other way. So what I do is I multiply the matrix associated with each gate. So I took the matrix associated with Hadamard, and I multiply it with the matrix associated with Z gate, and then I multiply the matrix associated with Hadamard again to obtain a final product. This is a simple matrix multiplication, nothing too complicated. And then what I do is, the product I obtain is, I just multiply the given matrix, the product I obtained, with the matrix associated with the state of a given qubit to obtain the new state. So if you paid attention, this given matrix is the matrix for Pauli X gate. So this also says, this also describes, you can see also, another important point is that you, there are certain gates which are only the universal gates, and you can combine those gates to make any operation in quantum computing. So let's move forward. So until now, we have been considering only a single qubit. But as I said in the one of the previous slides, the decoherence is a problem in quantum computing, then it would make sense that there are multiple qubits in a system as well. So that's when the decoherence part comes into play. So when we talk about multiple qubits, there is a special operation known as tensor product. if you're from a data science background or if you've worked with NumPy library or Python, you are already familiar with it. But let me describe you. It's a quite simple operation. So if I were to compute, you can say tensor product of this alpha, beta, and gamma, and delta, then this would be nothing but multiplying alpha with this whole matrix and multiplying this beta with this whole matrix again to obtain the product. So over 4 by 1 matrix. And this makes sense because 2 qubits can have maximal 2 to the power 2 or 4 states. And this is a simple example. This is nothing but you can say 0, and this is nothing but 1. So if you multiply this and we obtain this, which is nothing but a representation of the qubit 0, 1. These are some simple 2-qubit gates, the first being C0 gate, which works does exactly like its a classical counterpart, where we have a one act as a control qubit and the second act as a target qubit. So whenever the control qubit is set to 1, the target qubit just applies Pauli X gate on the target qubit. The swap gate does exactly what it says it does, that it just swaps the state. So if I were to input 0, 1, I'll obtain 1, 0. So now let me describe quantum superposition in much more a bit more details. So the best way to define quantum superposition would be to take an example of a coin. So if my coin was classical, then when I flip the coin, I'm expecting it to either point on heads or either point on tails. That makes sense because that's how coins work. But if that coin were to be quantum or quantum mechanical, then when I flip the coin, until I don't look at it, if I just flip the coin and I close my fist, and if I don't look at it, then the coin is in a position which is a combination of both heads and tails. When I look at it, it has to collapse on pointing either heads or either tails. So that's exactly how superposition works. Until we measure a given qubit, until then, the given qubit is in a state which is a combination of 0 and 1. So, but when we measure it, it has to collapse to point either 0 or to point either 1. So I've taken a simple example. I have an initial qubit 0. I pass it through a Hadamard gate, and we have already know that this should point in this direction. And when I measure it, it is a 50% probability of being in state 0 or a 50% probability of being in state 1. But it has to collapse to either one of the state. So that's what I'm trying to get here, is that measurement destroys superposition or any other property of, a qubit. Now let me describe quantum entanglement. Until now, I have described that entanglement can be defined as two systems which are separated by huge distances and can still interact with each other. A more technical definition would be that whenever two qubits are entangled with each other, then it is not possible for us to individually identify those qubits. So the best way to describe this complex, or technical thing to be, will be as John Preskill defined, that if I had a book containing 10 chapters, then it would make sense that the first chapter will have some details associated with the second chapter, and then the third and the fourth. We try to maintain a chronological order, such that even if I were to start from the mid, I were to start from the fifth chapter, then also I can make some sense out of it. Well, it won't be all gibberish and all. I could make some sense out of it. But things don't work like that in quantum realm. So if that given book was entangled, which means that each chapter was entangled with the other chapter, then it is not possible for me to understand anything any chapter says if I were to read those chapters individually. In order for me to make out what those chapter means, I'll have to view all those 10 chapters simultaneously. So I think that would make some sense to you and give you a bit of idea about quantum entanglement. Quantum entanglement is the most fascinating thing about quantum computing. And it was this which actually, triggered Einstein to be against quantum mechanics and trying to prove that quantum mechanics does not work out in actual nature. Let me give you a brief idea how we actually apply quantum entanglement. So we start with 2 qubits. This is a Bell pair, 2-qubit entangled pair, also known as Bell pair. And we start with 2 qubits. We apply, pass the first qubit through a Hadamard gate. So we already know that the Hadamard gate puts the given 0 in the superposition. So the 50% of time it will point 0 and 50% of time it will be pointing 1. So that makes sense that 50% of time, whenever this is given qubit is pointing on 0, the below qubit will also stay 0, when this is pointing in 1 or downward direction, then this would also get flipped along the x-axis, so it will also point 1. So we'll get the superposition of 0, 0 and 1, 1. which means 50% of time we will obtain 0, 0, and 50% of time we will get 1, 1. So that is a simple way of defining entanglement. So that's it. That was some of the important concepts of quantum computing. Now coming to the actual algorithm. So in this webinar, I'll be covering quantum teleportation. So you all must have heard about teleportation. You must have seen it in movies and TV series. So quantum mechanics and theory actually allows you to teleport things. The only catch being I won't be teleporting myself anywhere. I will be teleporting a given qubit from one point to another. So, and the tool we'll be using will be superposition and entanglement. So let me describe the scenario to you. So I have two friends, Ritik and Jay. And Ritik is a quantum physicist. So what he does is he generates a new qubit in a peculiar state, a state he is proud of. He's like, this is a state I want to show everyone. And he has a friend, Jay, who is also a quantum computing enthusiast. So he wants to send his qubit, which is in a special state, let it be alpha 0 and beta 1, to Jay. So how does he do that? He calls me and he says that I want to do this. How can I do that? So what I do is I prepare one pair of entangled qubits, which means two qubits which are entangled with each other. I give one qubit to Ritik and I give one qubit to Jay. So now let's see how things work out. The very first step would be for me to prepare the entangled pair. And I've already described the circuit for entanglement. We just pass a given qubit to Hadamard and use that, you can say, qubit as control qubit and the other qubit as a target qubit, and we obtain a superposition. Now what I do is I just distribute this qubit. I give one qubit to Ritik and I give one qubit to Jay. So this is the Ritik side of this is a Ritik's lab or Ritik's quantum lab, and this is a Jay's quantum lab. So what Ritik does is he in a way you can say simply encodes his qubit, his set of entangled qubit by the qubit which he wants to send. So this block sphere, this presents the qubit which he wants to send to Jay. So he uses that given qubit as the target qubit, as a control qubit, and entangled qubit which he has as the target qubit. So he's in a way encoding his set of entangled qubit in accordance to the message he wants to send to Jay. So then another thing important thing here is that if you paid attention, I said a line that Hadamard gate can be used to change the base of the measurement from z-axis to x-axis. So by passing his qubit, which he wants to send the message qubit to Hadamard gate, and leaving the entangled qubit alone, what he has basically done is he has basically if you were to measure that, you measure these two qubits, then his message qubit and his entangled qubit, what he's basically doing is he is measuring the angle which his qubit will make give the measurement which it makes along the z-axis, while the below or his entangled qubit will tell this the angle which his qubit makes along the x-axis. So now he has measurement of angle along z and x-axis by x and x-axis. And if you think about it mathematically, it would make sense that if we were talking about three axes, then if we knew the angle a given vector made along z and x-axis, then we don't need the coordinates for the y-axis, because it's easy. Because if I had the angle which I made z-axis, then I could also use the angle which it made along the x-axis to denote angle it would make along the y-axis. So thus, just by using z and x-axis, I can easily recreate the qubit. So what he does is this amount of information is sufficient for Jay to recreate the qubit on his side. Now, important thing to note here is that as I have been continuously saying that measurement destroys the state of a given qubit. Measurement destroys the state of a given qubit. So as soon as Ritik measures his qubit, he's actually destroying the qubit on his side, while Jay is recreating the qubit using the information which Jay, Ritik tells him. What he does is the measurement which he gets on measuring his message qubit and his entangled qubit, he just calls Jay and tells that when I was measuring my message qubit, it pointed on 1. When I was measuring that my entangled qubit, it measured 0. So by using those those values which Jay could obtain through phone call, he recreates the given qubit. So it was important for me to describe this because we are not copying the qubit here. We are destroying the qubit at one point and recreating it at another point. So That's it. You can say, or on the basis of the information that Ritik tells Jay on phone call about his measurement of his message qubit and his entangled qubit, Jay applies the Z and the X gate and is able to recreate the qubit. So you see that this message started from here and it was able to reach here. So that's how quantum entanglement, quantum teleportation works. Now, this whole webinar, I have been talking about, you know, telling you what's the advantage and why quantum computing is the future and what it brings, what new things it brings to the table. But the thing which you all have must have in mind is, then why don't we use quantum computers? If they are so good, then we should be using quantum computers. Why are we stuck on this classical computer? Well, there are certain things which are, you can say, preventing us from reaching quantum supremacy. The very first being noise. So as I told in your previous one of the previous slide, that we live in NISQ era, or you can say noise intermediate scale quantum, which means that the qubit which we are preparing right now is of low fidelity or of low quality. They disintegrate when left alone, and they do not behave properly. They have some you can say error associated with them. And the second would be decoherence. I also talked about decoherence, that when we talk about a quantum system, we want each qubit to act, multiple qubit to act as one system, but things don't work out presently like that. Qubit disintegrate, qubit affect each other. They try to maintain the individual identity. So we face decoherence. And then there's error propagation. So error propagation is a thing that made levels of much significance in the earlier time of, you can say, classical computing. When the computers were based on vacuum tubes. So the vacuum tubes has a very high, had a very high error percentage. So error correcting code has to be made, has to be, you can say, developed. The same thing goes for quantum computing. You can say that every time you pass a given qubit to a given gate, there is some error associated with that particular gate. So as you apply more and more gates on a given circuit, you are basically propagating error. You are just, you can say, stacking up the errors. So and in the end, that it is a question, you can say, it is a good question that if you can trust the output you get, if you pass a given qubit through various, you can say, quantum gates. So the results of quantum computing, certain problems and certain quantum computer, if they are not well maintained, is not so trustworthy because of the propagation of error as they pass through the various gates. And the last being expensive hardware. Let me tell you that making a qubit is not no joke. You can say, by an approximation, you can say that for the one qubit, it takes about $12,000 to manufacture one qubit with a very low fidelity. When I'm talking about fidelity, where you cannot actually trust the result of that the computation. So the hardware is very expensive, and it is not possible for small researchers or small, it's not possible on small scale researchers to actually contribute, other than the theory, of course. So now I'll just, let me just give you a brief of quantum use case of quantum computing, from where, I mean, you can say Ritik will move forward or take the discussion further. So some of the important use cases are cryptography and medicine and materials and machine learning and searching big data. So this will be more briefly than, you can say, more elaborately discussed by Ritik, my co-speaker. So if you were impressed by what you saw, what you heard today, and what you saw today, try to, you can go and visit our you can say blog Quiftix. The link will be provided. So I try to write articles in a way that generally anyone could get what the quantum computing is all about. And what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to prepare a community of enthusiasts like me of in the field of quantum computing. So that's it. Now I'm now open for questions, if you have any.
So guys, if you have any questions, you can ask them, write them in the chat box, and we'll take.
Thank you, Abhigyan. We will go ahead and take some time for questions. Just a reminder to all of you, please type your questions in the chat box. Any questions you can ask before moving to the next session, you can ask.
I think, Sakshi, it was very well explained. Or other questions aate hain, to last mein, yeah, you can give your email ID of Abhigyan also, so they can write the mail also.
Yes, on okay. That.
So, from Piyush Chaudhary. We got a question from Piyush Chaudhary. He's saying, why are we not going towards asynchronous computing? So,
asynchronous computing, basically, the quantum computing, the whole, you can say the principle of quantum computing works around superposition. Okay. So things don't work out asynchronously, actually, in this quantum realm. So when you talk about the superposition thing, the best example would be a Dutch algorithm, which was, you can say, the first algorithm, which actually showed that quantum computer can do anything. So it basically uses a superposition to parallelly solve a given function for multiple values using this superposition principle. So asynchronous computation wouldn't make much sense in, you can say, in this quantum realm. Because if you're not making full use of this superposition, then it's better to use this classic computer. Why use this quantum computer in the first place? So I think that answers the question. So I would like to thank my the faculty and the teachers for giving me this opportunity. If you have any further questions, you can contact me. My email address is right there, and you can visit the blog. Thank you.
Thank you, Avigan, for giving us the overview and telling us the concepts of quantum computing. So you all might be wondering, then where will we use it? Where quantum computers will be used in the future, or are they being used right now? So yeah, I'm going to tell you some use cases of quantum computing. So hi guys, my name is Ritik Joshi, and I'm a computer science honors student from, I'm doing my BSc from Ramanujan College. So yeah, let's just dive right into it. So first of all, we have cryptography. So cryptography being the data encryption, we need more and more secure data so that we can completely build our industries based on that. So quantum computers are famous for code breaking, but their real power may lie in making cloud computing more secure. Based on laws of physics, quantum computers have the potential to keep private data safe from snooks and hackers, no matter where it is stored or processed. So basically, in quantum computing, we have a qubit, which basically have two states. So we can store one bit of data, or you can say the whole data having two states in one qubit. Next up, we have medicine and materials. So quantum computing is basically based on the real world problems, and quantum physics is applied in the real world. So a quantum computer mimics the computing style of nature, allowing it to simulate, understand, and improve upon natural things like molecule and their interactions, and compounds better than a classical computer. And also the ability to process the data is also really good. The ability could lead to new medical advances and material discoveries. We are already using the virtual labs. We have used them before, as they are really useful for medical science researches and other fields related to that. Now we jump on to machine learning. So machine learning being the fastest growing industry, everyone wants to learn machine learning, wants to implement into their business, or you can say industries. And machine learning and quantum computing have given birth to a new era, or you can say new area of research, quantum machine learning. Quantum machine learning is an exciting and new area. Research indicates that quantum computing could significantly accelerate the machine learning and data analysis tasks, such as training of classic Boltzmann machines or topological analysis of big data. As having so much of data and analyzing that could be a problem for we have supercomputers as we have now, and some of them are going generalized through Intel's new processors and AMD's new processors. They are very fast, but still we need upper edge from everyone, and we need to keep on moving. So we are choosing quantum mechanics to enhance machine learning and other fields of science. Next up is searching big data. All companies been running on big data, using them even for elections, as you might know, obviously. And big data being constantly increasing, having a mammoth size data. So it is very difficult. It is not getting difficult, but it is always good to improve our, technicality and have a edge over other companies, and bring the latest technology to our industries. So a machine that can search the ever-growing amount of data being created and locate connections within it could have tremendous impact across many industries. Like we all know, Google stores our data, and obviously due to the storing of data by TikTok and other apps, they have been banned. But let's just not talk about that right now. Quantum computing offers the possibility of doing this significantly faster than classical computers. Further research will lead to the realization of this capability. So basically, till now, we are IBM, Google, these are the tech giants who are working towards making quantum computing a reality. obviously IBM have introduced a computer which could perform tasks. You can use it virtually through your normal machine using a Wi-Fi. And yeah, basically you must be thinking that why should we learn it, or what will be the future of that? So what will be the impacts of quantum computing on the economy? So when the first time computers came, they revolutionized the world. But we cannot certainly say this for quantum computers, as obviously we already have supercomputers which are working really fine. But as quantum computers will provide more and more secure and faster processing, with the storage of big data being very useful. So it is the next step, and it will definitely help you if you learn about it, because you want money, right? So you should be learning the new fields day and day after. How it will affect you? As I just said, Google and NASA have demonstrated that quantum computing isn't just a fancy trick. They have been working for it for a long time. You know, the IBM and Google have many research labs based on this, and constantly developing the idea of quantum computing and implementing in real life. Obviously, we don't have the funding right now. So Cryptix being a new community, we can't do that right now. But Google and NASA have said almost certainly something actually useful, that quantum computer is, studying quantum computing won't get wasted, or it is just not going to go in vain. They're already working on commercial applications. Commercial applications, just like, we'll talk about that later, actually. What does that mean for existing startups or businesses? Simply put, nothing, because we cannot have quantum computing applications and generalize them right now. But that doesn't mean you can ignore it forever. It is going to come in your industry, whether you are in research industry, obviously, and marketing or data analysis or any industry you can take. Microbiology, for instance. As I just told you before, the research could get really, really well. It could really help in processing the data that comes in all the time, and at a very molecular level too. So I want to deduce why I'm saying that. It will take a long time before anything real practical comes out of quantum computing. Why I said that? Because quantum computing being the new field, everyone is just focusing how it can improve their industry, or how can it help in that particular work area where, let's say, IBM. IBM wants always been building computers. The first computer was from IBM. And also, IBM is the leading company in that particular field. So they will be implementing and using the applications for their own purposes. Early applications will be incredibly domain specific and not generalizable. Basically, yeah, just as we talked about earlier, we won't be getting apps with quantum computing, circuits and other databases. We'll be using it just for industry purposes for now, as it will be improving. But we can expect it to be generalized and be common around in the next 10 to 15 years. So it is a really good chance for us to learn it and become the best in this field. And obviously, the money will follow. So I just want to give you an example of Kodak, who was a film photography company back in 1970s or something. I don't remember. So they used to film in using the film photography, using the reel. But as the data technology got introduced, they were forced to use the new technology, but they didn't understood that what is the actual capabilities and what with the resources that they'll be using. So they ignored it. But then they failed to act on the information, and Kodak could never recover. And most of you might not know them. As this story continues to develop, check back for updates on how quantum computing will help you and impact you and your organization, so that you could get to the top. So right now we are using some of quantum computing's applications in the field of AI. As we all know, AI being used everywhere, your phones, your laptops, you are currently seeing it, we are recording it, everywhere AI is used. So AI, in the robotics field, the quantum computers are really helping. Efforts have been made in recent years to solve classical robotic tasks using AI as an alternative. In the quantum realm, quantum neural network could help solve problems relating to kinematics or the mechanical motion of robots. The report states how the two levels of control in robotics, abstract task planning and specific movement planning, which are currently solved separately, can be solved in a more integrative way with quantum computing. So everyone who is interested or will be using robots, obviously in the future, will have to use quantum computers inside them. Machine learning, as I told you before, is being very much intrigued by quantum computing as the face recognition models and speech recognition models are being processed using the quantum computing algorithms. So being a computer science student, algorithm plays a very important role in making any program or any project successful. Quantum computing itself will introduce many new algorithms and sets of rules to work on. New languages, you can say, IBM have introduced some of the languages you can work on. They have provided you the platform to work on that we'll tell you about later. So machine learning being one of the main core using the core advantages of quantum computing. Financial market, why I picked it up? Because these markets are really predicting themselves and using quantum computing to do risk profiling, trade optimization, and target and prediction. Let me tell you more about risk profiling, how it will help. Financial services institutions are under increasing pressure to balance risk, hedge positions more effectively, and perform a wide range of stress tests to comply with regulatory requirements. So basically, they need more and more efficient and more accurate computation on their data required, as they might lose the customers, as we'll talk about in target and prediction. Today's financial services customers demand personalized products, as they want to invest in that company or that. They want their portfolio to be the best, and in which they these companies are helping really much. But to optimize that, quantum computing will be really helpful. Trading optimization just being another example of that. We can predict and specify which trade will be going up or going down, and we can measure it really accurately and fast. Obviously, having a qubit will provide us with immense speed to work on. And then after that, I want to combine financial market and AI to just tell more about that. In the banking section, of course, in the financial sector, the combination of AI and with quantum computing will help in improving and combat fraud detection. Model trained using a quantum computers could be capable of detecting patterns that are hard to spot using conventional equipment. At the same time, the acceleration of algorithms would yield great advantages in terms of volume of information that the machine would be able to handle for this purpose. Obviously, being a quantum computer, the speed is one of the main advantages, and using the lesser amount of data and providing better results will obviously help. Work is also being conducted in developing models. Okay, the quantum computers are being used in developing models that will allow to combine numerical calculations with expert advice to make final financial decisions. So obviously, all those who are interested in finance could be using quantum computers in the next coming 10 years or 15 years, as I told you earlier. So right now, it being one of the biggest industries, one of the biggest technologies to work on, it would be really helpful for you to study it more. And for us too, being the so you can study more about it and visit our blog quiftix.com, as we regularly post about quantum computing and the use cases of it and how you can jump into it and study it. So yeah, thank you so much. And now I would like to tell you some references from where I took the data. And if you have any questions, then you can please ask. I'll be more than happy to answer.
Thank you, Abhigyan and Ritik. Yeah, we'll go ahead and take some time for questions. Yeah, I think there are some questions in the chat box. Mm-hmm. Abhigyan?
Yes, ma'am.
You can take those questions one by one.
Actually, can you, ma'am, repeat some questions? Because I had to rejoin the meeting. So I can only see one question, the last question by Abhishek Chaubey.
Yes, there's one question from Abhishek Chaubey.
Okay. Yeah, I can see that. So let me answer that. Yeah, I have that question in front of me. So I can.
Okay.
So Abhishek Chaubey asks, also quantum error correction scheme do exist, but consume large number of qubits, that relatively few qubits remain the actual computation, that reduces the size of computing task to a tiny fraction. How would you justify it? Well, that makes sense because as I described that we are currently in NIST era, or you can say noisy intermediate scale quantum computing era. So the qubits which we are preparing right now have very low fidelity. And what exactly is a fidelity? You can say it's the possibility of the qubit to be pure and have less error. So it's like the best you can say anagram I could use is that in the early stages of classical computation, we used to have vacuum tubes. So the vacuum tubes were prone to very high error. I mean, any small magnetic disturbances or electromagnetic disturbances could easily destroy this given the state of the classical bit. So the things are exactly like that in quantum case right now. So until we find the transistor equivalent of the quantum computers, we have to stick with error correction codes like surface codes. So I think the closest approach that for error-free quantum computing is you can say topological computation on which Microsoft is working. Topological computation is actually a good step. You can say it's like transistors of quantum computer if it works. Currently, it isn't still in theory. So yeah, I would I agree that at the present scenario, being an NISQ era or error-prone era, it makes sense that most of the work has to be done in error correction and mitigation rather than actually preparing qubits until we find a better way of preparing qubits. So I think that answers your question, Abhishek.
Yeah. So another question from Aniket Srivastav, is there any way in which quantum computing may be capitalized upon via startups such as provision of quantum algorithms?
I think Ritik, would you want to answer that or should I answer it? You can go on and answer that.
You can go ahead first.
So I've been talking that the main, you can say that the title of this whole webinar is the future of computing, quantum computing, the future of computing. So we are reaching a point where you'll have to adapt to a different technology other than you can say the classical transistors and all. So it makes sense that the quantum computing, which has proved to be beneficial, your beneficiary, and it works in theory, to be the next step in quantum computing, we can't be sure about that. Of course, we can't be sure until we have a practically viable and less error-prone quantum computer. We can't be sure, but if you ask me, I would say that quantum computer is the future. So yeah, future startup will be based on quantum computation.
So having a startup, you need the funding. Is just the financial sides of thing that I look upon. So making a qubit is, as Abhiyan told you before, is very expensive. But we can definitely engineer it and provide certain value to the companies, which can in return provide us funding so that we can take it further. Yeah, so it is possible. So next up we have Pinky Valia. Is a qubit still considered digital or discrete? What exactly the difference between qubit or classical bit?
Okay, so the best example I used was the term, the coin. A coin could actually be answer a question. So you can say a classical bit is a simple coin. When you flip a coin, you expect it to point to heads or to point tails. So you can say it is discrete in nature. It is either one or it is either zero. But when you talk about qubits, well, the thing about qubit is that until you measure those qubit or until you see what the coin is, that particular coin or that particular qubit is in a state which is a combination of both the zero and one. So you're actually looking at, you can say, multiple values simultaneously until you measure them. So no, I won't describe qubits to be discrete. At the end, they are discrete because when you measure them, they have to collapse to either zero or one. But until you measure them, they are not discrete. And no, I won't be telling them to be digital as well. This is quantum computing. Classical concepts don't always, you can say, add up or you can say actually make sense in quantum realm. So yeah, this is some counterintuitive ideas, and you can read more about it. And yeah, I think that answers your question.
So and, we again have Abhishek Chaubey. Quantum computers are exceedingly difficult to engineer. Yeah, build and program. As a result, they are crippled by errors in the form of noise, faults, and loss of quantum coherence. Yeah, definitely. Which is crucial to their operation, and yet fails apart before any non-trivial program has a chance to run to completion. Yeah. So my question is, how do we get useful result out of a computer that becomes unusably unreliable before completing a typical computation?
So the point here is there's a whole theorem around this gate error propagation thing. So what happens is that to a certain degree you can accept the error. It's something like formula goes by 1 by 3 to the power something, I don't remember exactly. So of course there's error and there will be error in the time to come, but there's a certain degree of error which we can, you can say, accept, or which does not actually affect our end product. So the trick here is that you use certain gates and you arrange them in a pattern that that you use least amount of gates, but and yet you get the result which you would have obtained by using large number of gates. So reducing the number of gates, there's a whole concept. This particular thing technically is called transpiling a circuit. So transpiling a circuit basically means that you use certain gates which lower error fidelity to perform your operation and get better result. So yeah, I think we are still in early stages of quantum computer. Let me clarify. It is more of a theoretical subject than a practical subject right now. And this particular question falls in, you can say, the physics category of the quantum computing. And but yeah, I think that I can justify by what I said. So I think that answers your question. Thank you, Abhishek. Good question.
Next up, Ujjwal asked. Basically, he told that any new technology being adapted needs, you know, it is expensive to make a quantum computer. So Ujjwal asked that how can we make quantum computing a feasible thing and make it a practical thing, and what will be the time constraint and when it will be live. So in my opinion, as I just described, that it would take around 5 to 15 years. You can shrink down the window to 5 to 10 years, because constant development is being processed. And as these big tech giants are investing in this field, so we can see great improvements in the further years.
I would like to add to what you can say Sakshi ma'am says, because I think that Shikha ma'am asked a question about what programming algorithms, programming languages are available for quantum computing. So in this second answer, I can give you a good answer. So quantum computing, although it is still in its early age, is still computing. So we will need computer scientists at some point, although currently it is more of a physics oriented field, but at some point we will need quantum, or you can say computer scientists, to design algorithms on quantum computers. So there are two aspects, or you can say two different type of programming languages. One is more circuit oriented, the circuits which I showed you during this webinar, the gates, the qubits, the interference stuff, and so on. That particular aspect is best handled by Qiskit, which is a language by you can say IBM, and you can say Forest by Rigetti, and these two languages are quite peculiar. And when you come to the algorithm side, or actually coding algorithms on a quantum computer, which uses, you can say, high level language, Microsoft Q# is the best, and then we have StillQ, which is a relatively new language, and There is a Python equivalent. I don't remember the name exactly, but it is also quite high level. So I think, these are the languages which you can check out if you're interested in programming on a quantum computer.
Great. So I just provided some links that I used during this presentation, so you can go and check out further details. So next up, Pinky Walia asked, as you said, qubit and gates are more expensive, then why don't we use classical bit or classical gate? Quantum computing being another blend and being another field, so the classical bits actually won't work as far as I know. And if you want to add anything else, so you can.
So I guess what Pinky Walia is trying to say is that she's asking if it is possible to simulate a quantum computer on a classical computer. Well, in theory, that it is, you can say, as I said, that a quantum, or you say a qubit, has states which are more than, you can say, 0 and 1. So I'm not talking about, you can say, one qubit presenting only 0 and 1 until measured, of course. So it is not, you can say, it as we go on in adding qubits, we are exponentially increasing the number, the data which we'll be storing in that given qubit. I think you're getting me, because as I said, when I was talking about computing power, it takes double the number of transistors to add double the power of a classical computer. However, it takes just one qubit to double the power of a quantum computer. So you're looking at exponential increase in the computing power when you add a single qubit. So Okay, yeah, until now there are some classical simulation of the quantum computers or in the beginning we only had classical simulations only, but they were limited because our classical systems cannot simulate a quantum computer because of the large number of possible states, the exponential increase in the states as we go on to increase the qubits. So yeah, it is possible to classically simulate quantum computers, but it is very limited. You can say about 3 to 4 qubits. And let me tell you that we need at least 51 qubits before we can actually run any viable or commercially viable quantum algorithms. So I think that answers your question.
And thank also, if you are concerned about the speed and the efficiency, then they're already provided supercomputers from IBM and other NASA is using supercomputers. But obviously, the algorithms used in the quantum computer would be different. The work they do would be different. So it is not possible to use classical basically. So any more questions? Should we wrap up? Yeah. Thank you.
I think Sakshi, now you can end up the session.
Yes, ma'am.
Thanks.
It looks like we have covered all our questions. Abhigyan and Ritik, is there anything else you wanted to cover before a wrap up?
I would like to add a few things. I would like to say that don't be afraid of quantum computing. It although it has the term quantum in it, it is still computing in its core, and it's a future technology. So I won't say I can't just 100% give you assurance that the quantum computer is we will use quantum computers. And if you don't learn this one, you are just wasting your time. But quantum computer at some point in the time will have to be adapted, and it's better if you get used to it earlier than it becomes a necessity. So yeah, that's what I wanted to add.
Also, I would like to thank our faculty and all the present participants to listen at us patiently. I know quantum voting could be really boring at a point, especially when we discuss about the functioning. But I think Abhigyan really explained it really greatly, and you must have not got bored as you must have leave. So yeah, thanks for joining.
Thank you, each other participants. Thank you.
It being our first webinar, you should.
Thank you, Abhigyan and Ritik. It was very nice, very well explained. And in future, I also want ki agar aap isse aage, if you take the feedback from the audience, participants, if they want ki agar iska further bhi wo iska enhanced bhi karna chahte hain, to we can arrange one more webinar, isko extend bhi kar sakte hain, jo concepts aaj hue hain, so it can be the series also. So you take the feedback from the participants, ki agar wo iska advanced version bhi karna chahte hain, so say in the next month also, we can arrange one webinar for them. For the advanced topic, just take the feedback, and it was very nice, very well explained. And thank you all the participants, and special thanks to Vigyan and Ritik, and to all the faculty members of the department also, and to Sakshi ma'am for coordinating all the things.
Thank you, ma'am. It was a pleasure to be presenting here.
Thank you, Vigyan and Ritik.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Vigyan and Ritik, for your valuable time. And the session was informative and interesting. I hope everybody has enjoyed. We also want like to thank our participants. We appreciate you being here. I would like to announce that we will be sharing a feedback link on your email soon after this session. Kindly take out some time to fill out the same, and post submission you will get your certificates for participation. This will take some time, a week or so please be patient. Thanks again for joining us today, and we will see you next time.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you, guys. Thank you.